Good day, everyone. On behalf of Global CIO Forum and Juniper Networks, I welcome you all to this virtual summit on the Automated Data Center in Action. Before we kickstart the summit, let me just give you a very brief introduction about the event. In this webinar, we will be focusing on Juniper Apstra, the solution which helps you reimagine data center operations with closed-loop automation and assurance. The solution offers a new way of thinking about data center network operations. You start by specifying the outcomes you want, and the software will then set up the network, assure it runs as intended, alert you when deviations occur, and manage changes and maintenance. During the next 1 hour, we will learn how Juniper's Apstra solution empowers your IT team to automate the data center network. We will also demonstrate how the solution can reduce your design and deployment time from months or weeks to days or just even hours. Leading us through today's virtual summit are Fons Lodi, Director of Sales at Juniper Networks, Islam Mohammed, Senior Sales Engineer at Juniper Networks, and Haitham Sef, Senior System Engineering Manager for the META region at Juniper Networks. Before we kickstart the event, some housekeeping rules for our viewers and audience. All the attendees are on mute throughout the session, so please do post your questions to the chat option, and we will be more than happy to take those at the end of the session. Now, without any further delay, I welcome Fons Lodi. Fons, please take it over.
Thank you very much. Show my screen. Thank you very much. Also from my side, on behalf of Juniper Networks, I would like to thank you very much for your valuable time spending this morning with us. I'm really excited to give you some insights in Juniper's automated data strategy. I split out the presentation in a couple of topics. First of all, I would like to share some insights on the conversations we have today with our customers on cloud and data center transformation, and specifically how it impacts network operations. Then I will elaborate our approach in bringing experience-first networking to the data center, and of course with a focus on Juniper's Apstra Fabric Management solution. And then I will conclude with a short recap of Juniper's overall automated data center strategy before I hand over to Islam, who will provide you hopefully an exciting demonstration of our solutions. So with that, I would like to start with, you know, the mentioning, and this is probably not a secret, about the continuous rise of cloud services. So over the couple of years, we saw a tremendous growth of customers moving to the cloud, and especially, you know, last year's during the pandemic, there was a significant growth of worldwide 32% of growth for the hyperscale service providers, leading by AWS and Microsoft Azure, due to the simple fact that suddenly enterprises were forced to move from a physical world to a digital world in the way they interact with their employees, with their customers, and of course, if it comes to government, with the citizens as well. If you listen to Gartner, then Gartner mentioned that the vast majority of the enterprises will not move to a cloud, but will move to a multiple cloud. And while that brings a lot of benefits from an agility point of view, it will also bring some complexity on the operation side, in how to manage, operate multiple clouds and get end-to-end visibility on how your resources in those multiple clouds are consumed. So with that in mind, Juniper laid out that transformation to what we call the secure and automated multi-cloud, an environment where you manage multiple clouds as one single cohesive set of resources. We have split that out in intermediate steps, because that transformation will certainly not happen overnight. And during those conversations, we of course have a discussion around, okay, what is the technology you can use to move from your current mode of operations to your future mode of operations? But where we also dig into the what is the impact of from a process point of view and from a people point of view. During those conversations, what we found out is that many of our customers say, Juniper, it is very nice to have discussions around cloud, but for specific reasons, we cannot move all our workloads or applications to the cloud. Reasons like we have seen our first invoices from AWS, and we quickly found out that it is economically not feasible to move all applications to the cloud. Things as, and especially on the government side, on regulations or from security, from a data sovereignty point of view, that still a lot of applications needs to continue to run into the private data center. The second question, what we then get is, let's take that as a starting point and help us in driving complexity out of our own data centers and bring more automation into the data centers, so we can, from a data center point of view, we can accommodate the need for agility while having those workloads and those applications running into our own data center. The second angle, what we see is when we are talking to the DevOps environment. So a lot of organizations are introducing DevOps. The time that organizations are developing on new applications for 2 or 3 years, it's over. It's all about microservices where developers have sprints for 2 weeks, 4 weeks, to introduce new capabilities in the IT space. In order to do that, the DevOps environment, it is very important to have a strong alignment in what the development guys are doing and what the operations guys are doing. So it's all about open APIs, there's a lot of emphasis on open source tooling. And what is most important is that there is an integrated workflow between development and operations to shorten the time of development and introducing it into an environment. The complexity is when DevOps is really kicking in, and they have sprints of 2 weeks time, and they want to launch new microservices on the IT staff. And that if they go to the networking teams or the security teams, and then network and security team says, but guys, we need to have more time to be able to accommodate those services with the right quality assurance in mind, with the right security posture, et cetera. So here you see that specifically DevOps environments, they trigger a lot on public cloud providers, because there they find the agility what they need. So what we as Juniper are saying, there is a strong need for what we call automated NetOps environment, so that from a network operations point of view, there is a fully integration into the DevOps environment, and that from that point of view, the agility is in line with what the DevOps teams are expecting, while assuring the reliability, what you can expect from your data center. If you look into the different type of motions, you see, and this is a little bit a black-white picture. You see on one side, you see the hyperscalers, and on the right side, you see more the enterprises. The hyperscalers, if they talk about automation of their infrastructure, they are absolutely focused on having control of their own destiny. So their dependency is a lot on, you know, doing it themselves, very fast, highly open source and API driven. And if certain protocols or whatever, it's not existing, you know, they have the resources, money, and people in place to build it themselves. When we talk to the typical enterprise, the enterprise is saying, that is fine, but you know, we are not a Google, we are not an AWS, we don't have unlimited financial resources, we don't have unlimited skills to do it ourselves. So what those companies want is more convenient. They are looking for an easy package solution where they can take some of the benefits what the hyperscalers have and bring that in an easy packaged way to their own data centers. So some of the questions what we get from data centers, some of from the, our context into the from the enterprise data centers, is Fons, help us in getting away from the complexity of building and operating our own network. We are spending too much time in managing individual switches, working into the CLI, doing a lot of manual work, troubleshooting a whole fabric. We want to focus our attention more on having the conversations with our stakeholders on what do they want to achieve, what is their business intent, instead of staying 80-90% in the CLI and spending 80-90% of the budget on operational activities. Data centers are not becoming smaller. They are becoming larger, bigger. There are higher demands on what I mentioned earlier in launching new applications, new capabilities to interact with employees, with customers, with citizens. And the budgets are shrinking or at maximum stay the same. And the resources continue to be scarce. So how can Juniper help us as an enterprise to do more with less? The other topic is what I also mentioned earlier is how can Juniper help us with the trade-off between agility, fast introduction of new services, new capabilities, which brings business outcome to the customer, but also the main responsibility of network operations team is to provide a reliable and secure network environment. And that is a very, very sensitive balance between agility and reliability. And how can Juniper, help us? Where do we find the power of engineering and operations? In a similar way, like the DevOps teams are working. So how can we make sure that workflows are really integrated to each other, and that, you know, engineering and operations teams are working as, you know, one team, and know exactly what engineering is doing, what operations, what the impact is for operations, how the fabrics looks like, you know, and bring that back to engineering. Another topic is, you know, there is no lack of data. You can capture a tsunami of data on how the different network elements in your data center network is operating. But the complexity is how to derive meaningful knowledge out of that network, so that you have dynamic optimization and remediation. So that the whole troubleshooting, or meantime to resolution, or meantime to innocence, is shortened significantly. For that, Gartner introduced a new term into the data center and said the enterprise data centers, they need to evolve from manual work, operating individual network elements to what they called intent-based networking. And intent-based networking, with intent-based networking, you focus on the what. So what do you want to achieve from a reachability point of view? What do you want to achieve from a security point of view? What do you want to achieve from a quality of experience point of view? And then let software focus on how are you going to do that. So the how part needs to be fully automated. So with that intent-based networking, so in the way Gartner is describing that, Juniper acquired a company called Apstra in January 21. And what Juniper Apstra, the Juniper Apstra Fabric solution, as it is called now, is doing, is provide full automation for the for day one, for day zero, day one, and day two into your data center, in a unique intent-based approach, where the architects can really focus on the what question, and the how question on how to deliver that is done by the Apstra software application framework. Day zero and day one is just, you know, it's a limited activity. It's a couple of days per year. And the complexity is in day two. So with Apstra, you have the capability around closed loop validation. And that really supports on your day two operations on a real-time analytics where all the data in your network on how the fabric is operating, it is correlated and it is matched against the intent. So as long as the network is operating in the intent how the design of the fabric is built, then you are fine. So at the moment it deviates from that, then operators are alarmed with very, very specific information on, you know, where is the root cause, and give you insights on, you know, on making the whole troubleshoot activity in a very simple and easy way. The secret sauce of Apstra is, and that's a little bit under the hood, is the way we capture the intent and the structure of the fabric in a database. If you look, and we are using for that, we use the graph data model. And the graph data model is also used, for example, by Google, where they use that the graph data model as the repository for their entire network. And the graph data model is a highly scalable data model where objects, attributes of objects, and relationships between objects are stored, and that model can be modified or can be queried in a real-time fashion to make changes in your fabric. And the Apstra solution is highly dependent on the graph data model as a single version of the truth. So both the architect or the operator is working on the same graph data model. So what is typically information you capture in that? It is an object like a port, a line card, an individual switch, but also the fabric itself is an object with all the the attributes is, you know, the speeds, the quality of assurance, all the parameters from what is relevant for that, and of course the relationships between all the different components, and that makes it such a highly valuable information, because there is no handover needed anymore between what the architect is designing and the information on what operators are using for the day-to operations of the fabric. We are not doing this only for a Juniper underlay. The whole purpose of Apstra is to do it in a multi-vendor way. So to go a little bit more into the detail, is that from an automated and intent assurance operations point of view, that's much more as managing, you know, individual network elements like a switch or a board. The fabric itself is what you want to manage. And Apstra delivers you an abstraction layer where you can focus, where the architect really can focus on the what. The software will focus on how that intent is delivered to the components you are using in your fabric. And with intent-based analytics and root cause identification, the operator can really focus on, you know, when is the operation of the fabric not in line anymore with the intent of what is described as the intent, and why it happened. So it is not only finding the needle in the haystack, it is really about also eliminating that needle in the haystack. So if you go a little bit into the phases of design, build, deploy, and operate, and I'm very sure that that Islam in the demonstration will give you more insights. From a design point of view, we double down on EVPN, VXLAN, Spineleaf architecture. For the simple reason, it is an open architecture which is adopted by the majority of the network vendors. The complexity or the disadvantage of EVPN VXLAN is that it is, you know, quite complex to to design it and to build it if you don't have the right tools in place. So what we do with Abstra, we build an abstraction layer where the architect can design the EVPN VXLAN fabric in a very vendor agnostic way. And they can do it offline. So you, if you don't have any network switch in your data center, yeah, if you would start from a completely greenfield situation, the architect can already design the fabric and put in the business intent as it should work in a vendor agnostic way. Once you have done that, then the vendor agnostic blueprint will be translated in vendor specific blueprints, where we not only focus on our Juniper underlay, but also on the on other vendors' underlays, including what we recently announced, Sonic, for those organizations who want to go in that open network or an open computing evolution. It also provides a cabling plan. So once you have made the vendor-specific blueprints, it will provide an Excel. You can hand over to the operator. And then the only thing what the operator needs to do is make sure that that the switches and the ports are correctly cabled. After that, and once the pre-validation phase has taken place, so that what the vendor-specific blueprints, that it is in line with the vendor agnostic design, you push the button, and then there is a full ZTP process will take place to provision your fabric. Also for day two operations in that phase, you can put automatically your fabric or parts of your fabric in the maintenance mode so that you can do firmware upgrades or whatever. A highly valuable and important capability is also the time voyager rollback. So how many times, you know, it happened to us, you know, when you are operating your data center, that or your fabric, that you make a change overnight, and then suddenly, you know, next morning, things are not working as it should be. So with Time Voyager rollback, you can compare that for the ones who are using Apple with the Time Machine. So it's within three clicks, you can roll back to the configuration where you are absolutely sure that it was at that point working in the correct fashion. And that gives you a huge benefit and a lot of time saving and a lot of, you know, elimination of stress. Once, you know, you end up in a situation, yeah, what you, of course, preferably you wanted to prevent. Then from an assurance point of view, it's on a real-time basis, the intent-based analytics will continuously monitor how the fabric is operating. And it is matching that by using that single version of the truth with the intent as it is stored in the graph data model. And once it detects a deviation, all the information will be correlated, and then it provides you with root cause identification. It pinpoints you as an operator into the direction, like, this is the root cause. This needs to be solved if the platform is not able to do the remediation itself. The Abstra platform is not only focusing on the underlay. So recently we also announced a very tight integration into the overlay from VMware. So both on vSphere as well as NSX. So what we are doing here is that every other second, the abstract controller is polling the NSXT controller to see if there are changes in the VMware environment, which might impact the fabric itself. Once it detects that, it automatically make those adjustments into the fabric. So there is really a tight integration between the VMware world and the abstract world. So as a wrap up, in the broader automation data center solution strategy from Juniper. Juniper's big bet is around the EVPN, VXLAN, IP fabric architectures into the data centers. We provide not only, you know, the well-documented, thoroughly tested reference architecture, but also recently we announced what we called data center fabrics in a box reference architectures. These are pre-tested fabrics with Apstra on top of it, where all the blueprints are already in place, where the only way what you need to do is connect the fabrics into your data center, and then select the right data center in the box, the blueprints, and then push the commit button, and then you can provision your fabric data center in literally just a couple of hours instead of days and sometimes even weeks. Then on the next layer, of course, Juniper, as you are probably already aware of, we have a very rich portfolio of switches with cost optimized 25 and 100G switches, 400G platforms for those data centers who need to have large performance capabilities based on our own silicon, but also in a coincident release with Broadcom, all running Junos as a network operating system, with very, very comprehensive telemetry capabilities, which will be used by Apstra as part of the intent-based analytics point of view. Then the second step is, depending on your automation strategy in your data center, and I would like to remind you on the two different motions in a little bit of black and white way, where the hyperscalers have more an automation do-it-yourself strategy, and where you have the easy packaged solutions with the Juniper Apstra Fabric management. So to accommodate that automation strategy, we provide a lot of services where we help you in building up your own automation practice. Of course, heavily focused with open source automation blueprints, white papers, services, Ansible playbooks, and so on. The focus today is more on the fabric side with Juniper Apstra Fabric Management, which is fully intent-based, where you have automated workflows over day zero, day one, and day two with a very comprehensive analytics. And with that, we will focus on, you know, the integration of tomorrow, and actually tomorrow started today. with the tight integration into overlay technologies like VMware integration and Kubernetes, etc. So with that, I would like to hand over to Islam, who will give you a demonstration on, you know, how Apstra actually works on the different phases of your end-to-end life cycle. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fons. Thank you everyone for joining today. For the sake of time, please allow me to join directly to our today demonstration. As mentioned by Fons, Apstra has the capability to automate day zero, day one, and the day two, And given the fact that day zero and the day one is only happening a couple of days per year, so for today's demonstration, we already completed day zero and the day one, and we're going to demonstrate some use case for day two operation. As long as we have day zero and day one is completed, we will have something called the blueprint. Blueprint is your running configuration in your data center. So for today's demonstration, we have a data center fabric consists of two spines, two leaves, and three layer two servers. This is the main dashboard for the Apstra. Let's have 5 minutes to browse the capability for the tools before simulate the use case. This is the main dashboard. It gives you the status about your fabric itself. Actually, it's a key dashboard from a fabric health perspective. It's always comparing the current operation status of your fabric, and it will gonna compare it with your initial intent. And in case of any deviation, it will alert you by anomaly. For example, if you have an anomaly in cabling, if you have an anomaly in BGP session, if you have an anomaly in the routing table, it will give you an red alarm here, as we're gonna see. This main dashboard is using a predefined props. However, if you as an administrator are not satisfied with the predefined prop and you need to build your customized prop, you have the capability from analytics here. You can go to props and you can create your own prop. So for example, if you need to create your own prop, for example, to have a bandwidth utilization monitoring or to give you the device status or to give you the power consumption, you have the capability. The minute you'll create your own probe, it will appear in the main dashboard as we have seen. Then we have staged. Staged here, you assume the staged is your candidate configuration. Whatever change you will make to your data center fabric, it will be appear here and it will not go to the device unless you will commit your configuration. Uncommitted tabs show to you any configuration that is not saved to the device. As we are starting right now, we don't have any uncommitted configuration. The active stage, actually, this is your running configuration. This is your initial intent. This is your single source of truth. This is your golden configuration. As long as you have everything in green here, so you don't have any anomaly. So please allow me to simulate first use case. First use case is a configuration error. And as per statistics, 60% from service interruption is due to configuration error. So let's simulate here, one of the administrator will console to any of the leaves and he will add a wrong static route. So for example, I logged to one of the leaves using my console and I will add a static route here. I added a static route and I saved the configuration. Please allow me to compare. If we are using non-intent based networking, if we are using legacy networking, with that command has been added, you will not get any alerts unless this command will cause a service interruption and one of the users will complain that he cannot access a specific subnet or he cannot access any application. So without intent-based networking, you will be in the reactive mode or reactive approach. With intent-based networking, now with the main dashboard here, we should get a notification that we have a problem. If you can see here, I started to get one anomaly that I have a configuration deviation. So if you will double click here, it will tell you your leaf one has an issue. If I double click on my leaf one, if I will go to the configuration, it will tell you your actual configuration is already deviated from your golden configuration. So on the left hand side, it will give you your initial intent, and on the right hand side, it will give you the actual running configuration. If we scroll down, it will highlight here that your current configuration, including one static route, was not part of your initial intent. Mr. Administrator, what you wanted to do, you have two options here. Either you will accept the change, you will tell the system, yes, the new static route, I need to be part of my initial intent, or you will ignore the new change and you will apply the full configuration. Apply full configuration means you are ignoring the new added static route. Hitting confirm will back to your initial configuration. So this is first use case. My blueprint, my states, my main dashboard. It's a matter of time the anomaly will disappear from here. This is first use case. Second use case, you as an infrastructure department, you are receiving a request from your business team that they need to launch a new application. Without intent based networking, using the CLI mode, what you need to do? You need to assign a virtual machine for the business team to install the new application. You need to configure your ports on the leaf, assign the VLAN or VXLAN, assign the VRF, assign a new subnet, add the new subnet to the under relay routing protocol, build up your over relay tunnel for the VXLAN to be running. So it's a lot of configuration on a lot of individual devices. With intent-based networking, what you need to do? We need just to go to staged. We need to go to virtual. First, we need to create the VRF. We are calling here the security zone. So we'll create a security zone. For example, we'll name it product production. This is the name of the VRF. Then we need to configure our virtual networking, the subnet. So we'll configure, for example, a VXLAN virtual networking. Let's name it VN1. Which VRF, the VRF that we just created, the production, I need to assign a new subnet for the new application. For example, I give it a subnet and a gateway. What is the type of ports you need on the leaf? You need it unassigned, untagged, VLAN tagged. Let's make it VLAN tagged. Is this virtual network will be part of your all leaves, or you need to select a specific leaf? Suppose that I will assume I will select all leaves. Then I will hit create. I need to assign an IPs to the new VRF. This is a predefined pool on the tool itself. So I will select one of the predefined pools. Then I need to assign a VNI for the VXLAN for the new application. I will select the default pool as well. Now I am done with my VRF, my virtual network. I need to assign a network ID for my virtual network from the default pool. That's it. So now we created a VRF for the new application. We created a virtual network for the new application. Just double click on the virtual network and assign the port on the leaf. So now I double click the virtual network. I will go down. Here is my topology. The leaves and the servers, and for example, I will select on leaf one this port. I need to be VLAN tagged. You are done. Your under relays configured, your over relays configured. Your application can go live right now. But configuration, this is a matter of offline configuration. Configuration will not be pushed to the device unless you are going to the uncommitted, and we need to commit the change. One important note here: when you are commit any change, please give it a name that you can refer in the future. For example, I will name it Golden configuration with new app. Commit. Now your configuration is already pushed to your data center fabric. We have two scenarios here, that after configuring the new application, I have instability in my data center fabric. So from time voucher here, as Fonse clarified, you have the flexibility to roll back to your previous configuration. So the new configuration that I just did here, I gave it this name. This is the current configuration. And my initial intent, my golden configuration is also here. With one click here, I can jump to this version and ignore all last changes I did to create a new application. So this is second use case. So we simulated our own configuration and we simulated how to announce a new application. Last thing I need to show here in the demo, from the main dashboard here, suppose that some users is complaining from a delay or from a packet loss, and you need to have a live traffic visibility. From active here, you can select, for example, I need leaf one, and you can select here headroom view. From headroom view here, it will tell you that your leaf one is connected to two servers, and your leaf is connected to spine one and the spine two. You can use your cursor here to get the received and transmitted traffic per second. This is live traffic from your leaf towards your spines and towards your server as well. So if you have any non-green here, means that you have utilization or packet loss. Moreover, instead of the, as we mentioned, we have a real-time visibility, you can have time series. So you can go back in time at any points to check what I had in the configuration. One more thing that happens during the operation. During the operation, suppose you need to add a new server on an existing rack, or you need to add a new rack to the data center. Very simple. We'll go to our design. Then we'll go to our rack type. Then we'll go to our rack. Very simple. If we double click edit here, let's go to server. Now I have two servers in my rack. I can make it four servers. The minute you configure anything on the left-hand side, it's being visualized on the right-hand side, and you can update. So in a minute, I increase the server capacity in one rack from two server to four server. One more use the case, if you need to add a new rack, a brand new rack in your data center, you need to go to your template. This is my template. My template now, I'll select edit. My template now is including only two racks. I might add a third rack with a specific configuration. This is a third rack. It has been added, or I can increase the capacity from the existing rack. For example, from rack two, if I have one rack, I can make it 10. The minute you configure, it's already added to the topology. Just to commit, configuration will be done either under relay or over relay. So this is the third used case here. Also, if you need to have a telemetry from your data center switches, you can go to device, manage device. This is your four switches here, two spines and the two leaves. If you double click on one switch, go to telemetry, you have a real-time telemetry from that switch. For example, anomaly, no anomaly. This is the configuration on that switch. Also, you can check the interface status. All interfaces are up. You can check your LDB neighbors, your BGP status, your routes, your host name, your counters, if you have any errors, your ARP table. So from here, you can get a real-time telemetry from the switch itself, apart from the predefined props that we have seen here in the main dashboard, in addition to the customized prop that you as an administrator can use to get a specific telemetry from the device. With only 10 minutes till the closure, I will hand over now to the Q&A panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Haytham. Thank you, Fons and Islam. Now, I also would like to invite Haytham for the Q&A session. We're just running very short on time, so let me just quickly start with the first question. What problem does intent-based networking solve for enterprise data session? And how is it implemented? Fons, would you like to take this question?
Yeah, thank you, Manali, for that question. So with intent-based networking, we really want to drive out complexity out of the data center and let the network architects focus on the what question, on what they want to achieve with the networking data center fabric instead of the how part. And the how that is implemented and validated and implemented in an automated way by the Apstra solution.
Okay, Hazel, would you like to add on anything to this? Hi, Hazel, can you hear me?
Yes, hello. Sorry for that. Thank you, Manali. Thanks the audience. Thanks everyone for joining. Hope everyone is safe and healthy. So basically the intent, just to answer this in a bit of more detail on a use case. When you abstract all the complexity, all the logic from the CLI into a software tool, think about the possibility that you configure the network instead of devices as a system. So intent will provide the state, right? So we tell this software that this is the state I need the network to operate on. And then the software will decide what exactly configuration need to put on a place in order to achieve that state. And possibility here is so many. So the first that allow us or give us the capabilities to do any multi-vendor support, right? Because intent remain the same, maybe CLI is different. So a network operator does not really need to understand how to manage different vendor operating system or configuration in order to provide intent. Second is when we manage clouds, you want to be more agile, and part of being more agile is eliminating the human touch of every configuration or intent I need the network to do. You want to give intent to business, right? You want to give intent to cloud ops or to customers to provision their own workload, and having an intent based controller or an intent based network orchestrator will allow the applications or the cloud management system to submit to them. So the integration part is much easier, and it is much more automated when you abstract the intent from the network configuration and CLI. What's in it for our customer? That was the other part of the question. First of all, it's configuration mistake, right? So as maybe Islam demonstrated, today mistakes happen. It's part of the way we manage. And the more maybe, the more mistake we will do, right? And this is where we need to create the right balance and the right trade-off between being agile and doing the right thing, right? And this balance is very difficult today, especially that we do not have really the luxury of time in order to verify the configuration, have a four-eye look at the configuration and all the normal process that we use today in order to manage the changes on the network configuration. So intent-based will make sure that we have the best of both worlds. So we have the agility and also we have the accuracy and the reliability of the network state.
Okay. Thanks, Ethan, and thanks, Fons, for answering this. Islam, coming to you, after Juniper's acquisition of Apstra, will it focus only on Juniper data center, or you will continue to support multi-vendor environment?
Okay, actually, this is a good question because most of the people thought after Juniper acquired Apstra, it will gonna look in the products to only manage Juniper data center switches. However, this is not the fact. Juniper will continue the commitment for the Apstra to support multi-vendor. And this is already proven last release from Apstra with Apstra version 4 that already released after the acquisition. We continue supporting multi-vendor with more enhancement and more feature. So the bottom line here, we'll carry on supporting multi-vendor hardware solutions.
Okay. Thanks, Islam. Hitham, the next question is for you. What is Juniper's top priorities for 2021 of delivering cloud-ready data center?
Thanks again. And to answer that, I just want to also stress on the points that Islam made. So after the acquisition, a couple of days back, we have announced the new version of AOS or our Apstra operating system with supports for whatever vendors we use to integrate with, but also with the integration of NSX 3.0 and Sonic Enterprise Sonic operating system. So we have expanded actually our supports for a multi-vendor environments and for open data centers. Now, from priority point of view, our priorities, I think if we define the first top three priorities for us, is first to continue to develop the best hardware on the industry, and to that front today, or we have shipped the first 400G capable spine switches on the data center. That was last year, and we will continue to strongly drive 400G adoption on data center. This is something we see a lot of demand on. Not to forget that, okay, server sites now is moving into 25G, 50G, or 100G. So we'll absolutely need to invest on hardware. And our hardware strategy moving forward will be focused around our own silicons that we have on the high-end spines or some of the leaf switches. But on the same time, we will look at the off-shelf Broadcom chipsets. We have announced the first commercial available product with the QFX 5130 that support the Trident chipset version 4 or TD4, and we will continue to develop off-shelf chipsets for the agility point of view and also from to make it more commercially attractive to our customers. So this is first. It is hardware is part of our strategy. We will continue to develop the best hardware in the industry. Second is how can we modernize the operating system? How can we redesign our network operating system, Jonas, in order to meet the cloud requirements, especially when it comes to agility, to modularity, and telemetry data. We believe we have the first modular operating system and the best operating system on the industry for routing, the Jonas OS. And we have evolved that into the Jonas Evo or the Jonas Evolved operating system that runs today on our 400G products, but we want to also bring it to all our data center solution. And the third is the management and automation, how we can continue to develop the best orchestrator or SDN orchestrator for cloud-ready data center. And we can only do that by integrating with multi-vendor environments from a compute, from a storage, from orchestration system. And the ultimate target for Juniper when we build today any solution is experience first, right? So we want to make it easy for our customers to procure, to design, and to operate their data center. And this is the top priority for us for 2021. And forward as well.
Okay. Thanks, Ethan, for that. We've run completely out of time, but before we sign off, let me just quickly come back to each of you. 60 seconds each of you, and for the quick key takeaways. So I'm starting with you. What would be the main point you would like to highlight?
Yeah, so for me is that I hope we give you a little bit of flavor around how we increase reliability, simplicity, and velocity throughout the day zero, day one, and day two operations of your fabric. It is a flavor, but I also would like to ask you if you want to have more information. Please go to the Juniper Apstra Academy, and I will put the link into the chat, where you have a lot of free trainings where you can educate yourself on the Apstra Juniper Apstra solution and have the labs available there.
Okay, thanks, Juan. Over to you, Sam.
Yeah, I might say here that for the sake of time, we only connected very few cases to be demonstrated. However, for any customers who is looking for full demo to cover from day zero, which is Arctic, day one deploy, and day two the operation, He's most welcome to participate with us, just to communicate with your account manager, asking for a demo, and we'll be ready to support.
Okay, okay. Thank you, Islam. Hitam?
Yeah, I just want to thank you and thank everyone. And we're closer to everyone than they think. We are available to support them. If they have any requirements, they want to find more details, we're happy to do so. Regardless what current infrastructure they do have, we will have a solution. We want to bring them into an experience for their center. We have the people, we have the tool, and we have the solutions to do so. So please, if you need anything, you know how to reach us. We are available on each and every country on Gulf, and we will be happy to support you where needed. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Fons, Islam, and Hitam. And with that, it's just time to wrap. And I would like to thank all the attendees and the speakers for being with us today. We look forward to seeing you again. Goodbye and have a nice day.